Praise the Lord. Yeah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Yeah. Our God is alive. Yeah. Let's celebrate Him. Glory. Let's celebrate life. We celebrate life this morning. Hallelujah.
Thank you. Glory. praise the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. You act like you believe he's alive today. We celebrate the resurrected Savior. Amen. Our resurrected Savior. Well, if you can be seated, you can. Now's the time. Amen. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. 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 Yes. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Amen. Amen. We're going to let you be seated for a moment. Yes. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. Glory. Glory, glory, glory. Well, we like to take this time to welcome you on Resurrected Sunday, amen. Resurrection Sunday, amen. Amen, amen. I feel so full this morning. I feel so full this morning. I praise the Lord for his goodness, for his love, and for his mercy towards us, amen. We are here today because of Jesus. Amen. 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 Well, we want to take this time to welcome our guest. If you're worshiping with Victory for the first time, we are so happy that you're here today. If you are worshiping with us for the first time, there's something we'd like to put into your hands to tell you more about our church. So if you could please slip up your hand if you're visiting with us today. Amen. God bless you. Yes. Amen. Amen. And if you don't mind, am I keeping your hands up? They're coming around now to give you a handout. There's those on this side that need handouts. Amen. Amen. All right. Okay. Do we have, okay, praise God. Yeah, there's more hands over here. Amen. Let's clap. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Amen. We are a visitor-friendly church. Amen. We are so excited about you visiting with us. And then those of you that are on the stream this morning, we are happy that you have tuned in this morning. The Lord bless you. Amen. And we would like for you to text welcome. If you're visiting with us for the first time, please text welcome to 773-378-9253. Praise the Lord. Amen. Amen. I'm also up here to give you some brief announcements. Praise the Lord. I know they're trying to get people seated, but I'll just go on with it. You know today is Resurrection Sunday, amen? Some may call it Easter Sunday, but we're talking about the same thing, amen? But we know it as today our Savior and Lord rose with all power and authority in his hand, amen? But I want to tell you about some important things going on here at Victory. Sunday, April 14th, come on over. She could tell it better than me.
Good morning, everyone. Happy Resurrection Sunday. Hallelujah. Yes. April 14th is our Pastor Appreciation Day. All day. All day we're going to praise and love on our pastors. Our guest speakers are Overseer Apostle Dave and Pastor Felicia Gaines. Our theme is celebrating the faith, virtue, victory, and vision of our pastors. So we look forward to seeing you there 2 weeks from today. So we look forward to seeing you. God bless you and keep you.
Amen. 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 And also, the bookstore wanted me to announce that they have 10 baskets left. And these baskets are at a very good price. So if you haven't gotten your baby or grandbaby a basket, there are a few left in the bookstore, 10 of them. And you're welcome to get one today. Amen. Amen. Price is very good, $10. Am I right? Yes, praise the Lord. Amen. on Tuesday night. We are here in person, our in-person prayer, 6:30 to 7:30. It was 2 hours, but it's now 1 hour, so we want you to make note of that. 6:30 to 7:30 here in the sanctuary. Grief Share Support Group meets every Tuesday at 7 p.m. unless they're on a break. But they meet every Tuesday at 7 p.m. You want to see Sister Angela, if you could raise your hand, or Sister Patty Norsworthy for registration. And there are others that you could also see. Baptism Sunday is every fourth Sunday of every month at 10 a.m. here in the service. Intercessory prayer is ongoing through the week. You can join us. We have a conference call prayer on Tuesday morning, every first and third Tuesday at 10. But we also, as I said, evening prayer, but then Saturday morning prayer too. How many know we need to pray at this time in our lives? Amen. We need to pray. So, amen. Well, that's all I have. Amen.
Praise the Lord, everybody. You all look so beautiful today, and we welcome you here at Victory in Christ Kingdom Church. My name is Pastor Eric Susbury, and we are so excited that you are here today. I was praying this morning, Lord, don't, after I looked at the weather, I said, Lord, please let it rain after the service. And he has granted my request. Well, praise the Lord. That's one sign and wonder for today. I want to come up at this time to take up our Sunday morning tithes and offerings. We thank you for your partnership with the church. We couldn't do what we do without faithful financial supporters that give to the work of God. We thank God that the gospel is free, but it does cost to get it to people. We thank God for Jesus Christ dying on the cross for our sins. He was the greatest gift given to us. And when we get back to him, you're showing him our appreciation for all that he did for us at the cross. Jesus said it like this, give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over. Everybody say running over. Shall be given unto you. For the same measure you give, it shall be measured back to you in abundance. Well, I tell you, God, you can't outgive God. I like to say it like this. He's daddy God. He's always going to have bragging rights. You never can say, God, I gave God this much money and he didn't give me anything. No, he's going to always have the last say. This lady came to our church. Well, actually, she never came to our church. Her attorney came to our church. And he had a client that died and left a whole lot of money. And he called me up one day. My daughter, who's also a lawyer, works at his law firm, said, hey, Pastor Eric, Uncle Eric. She called me Uncle Eric. She's my niece. My niece. She said, Uncle Eric, Mr. Scannell want to talk to you. And it was on a Monday. I said, oh, on a Monday, that's my day off. She said, Uncle Eric, it would be to your advantage to come to Mr. Scannell's law firm. Well, I came there. I was a little disappointed because I really wanted to relax on Monday. And I sat at the table, and the lawyer threw me this piece of paper and this check, and the check was for $300,000. And you know what? The first thing I said was, is this real? And they said, yep, it was real. And I tell you, we used that money and paid off the church. Well, I tell you, God is good. You can't outgive God. You can't outgive God. You cannot outgive God. And let me say this one more thing. Whenever God talks to you about sowing a seed, he always has a harvest on his mind. He's thinking about what he's going to give you as a result of stepping out in faith. Well, let's give to God, knowing that we can't outgive God. God gave us his greatest gift, his son Jesus Christ, who died on Calvary's cross for us. None of us could pay for that, but we can show a token of our appreciation, our giving back to him in abundance. Well, we have a number of ways to give. You can give online. You can go to victoryinchristkingdom.org. You can text to give to 855-943-2337. And, or you can go Cash App. That's Cash App, Vic, 2735. Or you can go in the back and give your tithes and offerings through a debit or credit card, however you want to a give. And we're so excited. I remember when I told my father that story of the money being given to our church. My father was at the nursing home, and I told him about it. And I said, "Hey, Dad, I want to make a resolution." And my father said, "What's the resolution?" I said, "I'd like to make this lady, Miss Polis, a member of our family." For giving that money. And my father just laughed and whatnot. But he was excited too as well about how God blessed our church. Well, God will bless you too. Well, let's bow our heads in prayer as we pray over our tithes and offerings. And you don't have to bring the offering basket up at this time. Let's bow our heads. Father, we just thank you, Lord, for your goodness. We thank you, Father God, for your great love. We thank you, Lord, for this Resurrection Sunday, Lord, which the fact that you came up out of the grave makes the big difference in our lives. It really matters how we respond to his resurrection. And Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this opportunity to give to you. Lord, we can't outgive you because you gave your greatest gift, your son Jesus, to die on the cross for all of our sins. But Lord, in a small way, we can show our appreciation. And we thank you, Lord, for every gift. Lord, let every gift be used for the furtherance of the gospel, that other men, other women, other little boys and other little girls might hear the good news of Jesus Christ and get saved. Father, we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well, we're going to have a presentation by the dance ministry. Let's welcome Kelsey as she comes and blesses us. Praise the Lord. George.
Stand still and see the promise. 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 Stand still.
Stand still and see the promise.
Faithful to perform.
Stand still and see the promise.
Thoroughly persuaded.
Stand still and see the promise.
you can do exceedingly, abundantly, above. I am thoroughly persuaded that you can do exceedingly, abundantly, above. Stand still and see. Stand still and see.
For the children, they have a presentation they want to present to us today. So if you bear with us, they'll be right up. Are you all coming up? They're waiting.
Jesus said to her, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. John 11:25.
Bunny eggs and jelly beans, that's not what Easter really means. Every year we celebrate.
A day of great joy.
S, someone loved us so very much.
T, that even death could not destroy.
E, everlasting hope now exists for everyone.
R, reminding us that Easter is what about Christ has done.
Lift your name on high. so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank God for our little ones. We love our little ones here at Victory. Amen. Praise the Lord. I saw my nieces up here. They're from Cincinnati. I didn't know that they've been practicing this song. But it was beautiful to see them up here. Praise the Lord. Jesus said, suffer little children, forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of God. My wife just corrected me, my grandchildren. Praise the Lord. So much going on today. So many wonderful things. Well, if you have your Bibles, turn with me to Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. I'd like to again say welcome to Victory in Christ Kingdom Church. We're so glad to have you celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the grave. Amen. Jesus Christ's resurrection is at the heart and soul of the gospel message of Jesus Christ. And we want to present to you the greatest story ever presented to humanity. And that is God sending his son Jesus Christ to die on the cross for our sins. He was buried, but thank God he rose on the third day. We serve all those who believe in Jesus, serve a resurrected Jesus, a Jesus who's alive. If you agree with that, say amen.
Amen.
Let's bow our heads in prayer. Father, we thank you and we praise you today. We thank you, Lord, for everyone coming out today, Lord. We ask, Lord, you speak to everyone here individually, Father God, what you would have to say, especially to them on this special day. Father, we thank you and we praise you in Jesus' name. And everyone said, the title of the message is The Hope of Resurrection. The Hope of Resurrection. Can you say that with me? The Hope of Resurrection. And the subject is why the resurrection of Jesus Christ matters today. Why the resurrection of Jesus Christ matters today. Luke's Gospel, chapter 24, verses 1 through 12. It says, now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and the certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing the spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went and did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. And it happened as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but he is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee and alive, saying, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and the third day rise again. But they remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 other disciples and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary, the mother of James, and the other women with them who told these things to the apostles. and their words seemed to them like idle tales. And they did not believe them. But Peter arose and ran into the tomb, and stooping down, he saw the linen cloth lying by themselves. And he departed, marveling to himself at what had happened. In our text, we just read, two women came to Jesus' tomb to finish preparing Jesus' body, but something very strange had occurred when they arrived. The stone that was originally placed in front of the tomb where Jesus' body lie was rolled away. And when the two women went inside to look, Jesus' body was no longer there. And then suddenly two angels appeared. The garments of the angels appeared like lightning. The women fell down, bowing in reverence. The angels asked a pointed question. And it's this: why seek ye the living among the dead? Why are you here looking for a dead Savior? Now, what the angels was saying to the women was kind of a rebuke. They were seeking to honor a dead Savior. A Savior who, as with all other people, all other men, all other human, are frail and powerless to do anything about life and eternal life, life after this life. Unable to do anything. The angels then proclaim the most glorious news that's been going on for 2,000 years. He is not here. He is risen. The angels proceeded to remind the two women that Jesus had foretold of his death and his resurrection. The two women then left the burial place to tell all the other disciples that Jesus had risen from the grave just as he said he would. And this same message of Jesus risen from the grave, even though it happened over 2,000 years ago, is still being preached and shared today, that Jesus is not dead, Jesus is alive. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We serve a risen Savior. He's not dead, he's alive. He's at the right hand of the Father, ever living to make intercession and prayers for you and I. Today, all over the world, people are hearing the message, some for the first time, that Jesus died, was buried, but then he arose again. Now, your response to Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection will determine your eternal destiny. He is the only Savior who came and said, if you believe in me, even if you die, you can live again. Amen. Jesus said in John 11:25-26, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though they die, yet shall they live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. Jesus Christ's resurrection from the grave is at the heart and soul, and it's the defining teaching of the Bible. And without a resurrection of Jesus Christ from the grave, Christianity is nothing more than human philosophy on par with all the other religions, creeds, beliefs, and teachings. Archaeologists have found the burial site of many Egyptian greatest kings buried in massive tombs with great wealth. And yet all of these kings are still there in their graves, very much dead. The Taj Mahal in India is one of the world's most dazzling tombs, and its occupants are still there, very much dead. Muhammad died in 632 AD, and he is still in his grave in Medina, very much dead. In the Red Square, Russia, Moscow, Vladimir Lenin. Putin ain't dead yet. I know some of y'all wish he's dead. I was just tricking y'all, see if y'all. But Vladimir Lenin, even though they're doing everything they can to preserve his body, he is still in Russia, Moscow, Russia, very much dead. However, this is not the case with Jesus Christ. The story took place in just 3 days. On Friday, before Jesus' crucifixion and death, Jesus stood in a court of law before Pontius Pilate, the governor and the judge, and the religious people who were there to come up against Jesus, and a host of people were there in the court who did not like Jesus Christ, because he said, if you see me, you have seen the Father. And he was proclaiming that not only was he the Son of God, but he also was God. And they wanted him dead. On Friday, Satan was happy that Jesus was going to be pronounced crucified till he died. On Friday, Satan and God's enemies, who is God's enemy, and every enemy that hated Jesus, along with a host of fallen angels and demons, had a celebration when they found out that Jesus was sentenced to death and he went to the cross. The Bible says they whipped him first. They put a crown of thorns on his head. They put nails in his hand and nails in his feet and put him on an old rugged cross. And they pierced him in his side, and blood and water came out, proving that Jesus was no longer alive. And they took his body down and put it in a grave, but deep the whole host of hell and all the demons in the world were having a party. They were having a celebration on Friday. Everybody say on Friday. On Friday, as I said, they put a crown of thorns in his hand, on his head, nails in his hand, nails in his feet. They hung him to the cross, but he died. But on Friday, the sky became pitch black and darkness covered the earth. And the Bible says that a great earthquake happened, and one of the Roman guards that was standing watching Jesus die on the cross, and he saw the darkness and he saw the earthquake, the earth shook, and he said this, truly, this was the Son of God. Truly, this was the Son of God. On Friday, all hell was rejoicing and toasting and giving five. All that happened on Friday, but on Sunday morning was a different story. On Sunday morning, Jesus rose up out of the grave. On Sunday morning, Satan couldn't stop shivering. On Sunday morning, all the satanic hosts couldn't stop shouting and screaming bloody murder. On Sunday morning, the demons couldn't stop hollering and screaming. On Sunday morning, the witches and the horlocks couldn't stop screaming. On Sunday morning, all the curses and satanic soothsayers and all the false prophecies began to stop. On Sunday morning, people that hated God began to stop. On Sunday morning, people who hated the purity of God, the love of God, the goodness of God, all were shocked at the fact that Jesus got up out of the grave. and he's alive. Jesus is alive. When Jesus came up out of the grave after paying the sin penalty for your sins and your sins and your sins and my sins, he got up out of the grave and he said this, I am alive forevermore. Behold, I have the keys of death, hell, and the grave. I can control death, I can control hell, and I can control the grave. I have come and I've died on the cross and paid the penalty for the sins of the whole world, and now I overrule death, I overrule hell, and I overrule the suffering that comes when into a person's life who has not accepted Jesus Christ. I have the power to overrule if they accept me as their personal Savior. Jesus rose up out of the grave. Now, as a result of Jesus being our sin substitute and having took upon himself the sins of the whole world, God wants us to know three things that will matter to you if you receive Jesus Christ. How many people know the resurrection of Jesus Christ matters to you? It matters to the next person next to you. And that matters to the person behind you and the person in front of you. Jesus Christ's resurrection matters to you today. Three things you must acknowledge and you must understand that it matters. You must acknowledge that you are a sinner. If the resurrection is going to matter to you, you're going to have to acknowledge that before you come to Christ, you're a sinner. You have sinned, and your sin has separated you from a holy God. The Bible says in Romans chapter 3, verse 23, the Bible says, all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. What is sin? Sin is disobedience to God's word. Sin is doing your own thing. Sin is going your own way. Sin is hijacking your own life and saying, God, I'm going to do with my life what I want to do with my life and not what you want to do with my life. Sin is just telling God that you're going to go your own way. God hates sin because of what it does to people's lives. It steals and it kills. It fascinates and assassinates. Sin will take you farther than you want to go and keep you longer than you want to stay. God hates sin because of what sin does to us. Sin destroys. The Bible says, for the wages of sin is death. And we weren't supposed to die. That death didn't come in until Adam and Eve disobeyed God. God put the first two human beings in the garden. He said, of all the trees, y'all may freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat thereof, for in the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt die. Why did God not want them to know the tree, touch of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil? Because he only wanted them to know good. He did not want them to know evil. Well, what did they do? Eve listened to Satan. Eve told her husband, it's okay, we're going to be like God. They didn't realize that they were already made in the image of God. And you know what? What they did, they ate of the forbidden fruit. And as a result, they died. And not only did they die, but death, as a result of their sin, came all the way down to the human race even today. You weren't supposed to die. Your cat wasn't supposed to die. Your dog wasn't supposed to die. The tree wasn't supposed to die. Death came in when sin was committed by the first two human beings, Adam and Eve. But the good news is Jesus came to reverse the effects of sin. Somebody say praise the Lord to that. The Bible says in Romans chapter 5, verse 8, that God demonstrated his love for us and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Somebody say praise the Lord. Say, he died for me. Now, before I give you the final good news regarding why Jesus' resurrection matters to us today, Jesus rose from the grave to favor us and give you abundant life. Everybody say abundant life. abundant life is the kind of life that God wants everybody to live. Jesus said, the thief cometh not but for to steal, kill, and destroy, but I came that you might have life and have it that more abundantly. You know, there are people that are broken all over. You can see it. They're hurting. They're empty. These people will try to and do anything that will bring them some type of satisfaction or some type of relief. People even try things like drugs or alcohol or sexual impurity or emotional or psychological drugs that'll take them someplace. I was hearing about the fact that this guy named Drake, he even went around with this philosophy saying, it goes like this. He says a saying that he says, and that's YOLO. Some of you young people know what I'm talking about. YOLO means you only live once. But that's not true. The Bible says it's appointed to all people once to die, and after that, the judgment. See, if there was no judgment, you could live any way you want to, but the Bible says it's appointed to all people once to die, and after that, the judgment of God. Well, God doesn't want us to experience judgment. He took upon himself the judgment, the sins of the whole world. He paid the penalty for your sins and my sins at Calvary's cross. So the question is, what is the solution to the emptiness, to the brokenness, to the dry, the thirst, the hunger of people in society today? What is the answer? Some people say it's money. Money. Everybody say money. Money can buy love, but it can't buy true love. Money is good, but money, it can buy a friend, but it can't buy a true friend. Money can buy peace and happiness, but it can't buy true peace and true happiness. The only thing that can give you true peace and true happiness is Jesus Christ. Amen. He's the only one to meet the deepest needs of your life. His hand can go in your life where no other hand can and touch your innermost, deepest need. The good news is Jesus said this, that there's an enemy out there. He's a thief, and his name is Satan. And he comes to steal, kill, and destroy. But Jesus came that you might have life and have it that more abundantly. Somebody say praise the Lord to life. Everybody say praise the Lord for abundant life. Now, abundant life is life before you get to eternal life. God doesn't want you just to wait till you get to heaven to get happy. He doesn't want you to wait till you get to heaven to have some peace. He doesn't want you to wait till you get to heaven to have some joy and some freedom and some deliverance and some power. You can have heaven come down to you right now. Everybody say, I want mine now. Y'all heard of the commercial J.G. Wentworth, right? I need my money now. Say this, I need my peace now. I need my joy now. I need my happiness now. I need my breakthrough right now. Jesus said, I came that you might have life and have it that more abundantly. Everybody say abundant life. Jesus offers everyone abundant life. Jesus rose from the grave to give you the best life that you could ever have. I thank God that I answered the call to pastoring. I remember I graduated from college, and me and my wife got married, and I sat at the kitchen table one day, and I was looking all sad and everything. My wife said, Eric, what's wrong? I said, God want me to be a preacher. I don't want to be no preacher. But I thank God today. I thank God today that I caved in and said, God, I'll be whatever you want me to be, because you know the abundant life that you have for me, and you established abundant life for me before I was in my mother's womb. And I tell young people, if you want your best life, if you want your best life that you can have down here on planet Earth, before you go to heaven, after making a decision to go to heaven, you need to give your heart to Jesus Christ. He will give you your best life. He will give you the greatest life that you can have. And I thank God today that I answered the call, because I'm living the best life I could ever live. Now, you can choose to go your own way. That means you got to go through every storm, every trial, every court case, every accident. You got to do it all by yourself. But Jesus said, when you come to him, he'll give you eternal life. Eternal life, it means, let me tell you what eternal life means. Eternal means a life free from the bondage of sin. Eternal life means a life complete, not lacking any essentials. Eternal life is a life that is successful, superior in quality. Eternal life is a life that is filled with all God's things, all good things from God. Eternal life is a life of happiness and peace and joy and freedom. Eternal life is the best life you can live here on planet Earth. Now, I would be remiss if I didn't tell you that even though you accept Jesus Christ and get eternal life, life that leads to eternal life, down here, life down here, while you're here, I would be remiss if I didn't tell you that you ain't gonna go through no storms. Amen. I'd be lying to you. But I'm here to tell you, because Jesus rose up out of the grave. He said, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. God says, I'll make you, the storm may come, but I'll make you bigger than the storm. I'll make you get through the storm. I'll take you by the hand. In fact, I'll take the storm and I'll make you the storm to make you better, to make you stronger, to make you wiser, to make you more powerful. And God promises in his word that he will never leave you nor forsake you. If you call on him, if you stand in his presence, God wants you to get into his presence. He wants you to come to him because he wants to protect you. You don't have to worry about the bad guy or this getting shot or whatnot. God will protect you. God's word, if you don't know his word, you need to know his word, because in Psalm 91, he says, he that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. And I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in him will I trust. Surely he shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the noise of pestilence. He shall cover you with his feathers, and under his wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler. Thou shalt not be afraid of the terror by night, nor the arrow that fly by day, nor the pestilence that walketh in darkness, nor the destruction that wasteth at noonday. 1,000 shall fall at your side. 1,000 may fall at your side. 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come nigh you. God promises only with your eyes. Only with your eyes. The enemy coming up against you, and God says, I promise you, you'll look at them suffer right in front of your face. Only with your eyes shall y'all behold. It ain't gonna come nigh you. You're gonna observe it. Say, I'm gonna observe the enemy fall before my face. Only with thine eyes shalt thou behold and see the reward of the wicked, because thou hast made the Lord, which is thy refuge, even the Most High, thy habitation. For he shall give his angels. He shall give his angels. You got angels. That's abundant life. Angels. For he shall give his angels charge over thee, lest thou dash thy foot against a stone. Thou shalt tread upon the lion and the adder, the young lion and the dragon shalt thou trample underfoot, because you have set your love upon him and you have known his name. Do you know his name? In the Old Testament, his name is Jehovah. What does Jehovah mean? Jehovah means the same thing God meant to Moses when God told Moses what his name was. He said, my name is I Am. In other words, God was telling Moses then, and he's telling you today, if you accept Jesus Christ, you can call Jehovah, and Jehovah says, my name is I Am. That means I will be whatever. I will be whatever you need me to be in the moment that you're going through. If you need a helping hand, I'll be a helping hand. If you need healing, I'll be your healer. If you need protection, I'll be your protection. I am whatever you want me to be. That's abundant life. That's the life you need. That's the life God doesn't want you to pass up today. God wants you to have abundant life, abundance of peace, abundance of joy. Hello, somebody. Say, I got abundant life in Jesus Christ. Now, you can only say that with conviction if you have accepted Jesus Christ personally as your personal Lord and Savior. Grandma can't save you. Mama can't save you. They can tell you about the good news of Jesus Christ, but you have to respond to him. You have to acknowledge him as Jesus, the Savior, the Lord, the Messiah, the one and only God that can deliver and bring salvation. Glory! That's something to shout about. Y'all got me preaching. I broke my glasses. But that's okay, because God wants you to get the abundant life. You don't have to wait till you get to heaven to have abundant life. You can have authority and power right now. Jesus said you can have authority in prayer like this. He said, whatever you bind on earth, I'll bind from heaven. If the enemy's messing with you, all you got to do is bind the devil in Jesus' name. Hello, somebody. Say, bind the devil. I'm going to tell y'all this story. Y'all want to hear this story? I was in construction before I became a pastor. And I was doing work, and I was invited to the architect's house to get some plans, to pick up some architectural drawings. And he had a dog. Everybody say he had a dog. He had a dog that came out. I was sitting in the living room. His dog came out and licked my hand. I thought he was being nice. I thought the dog would be nice. And I have a very sensitive taste, a sensitive throat, palate. And I forgot that the dog licked all over my hand. And when I was in the car, I grabbed some water and I drank it. And the moment I drank it, my throat started getting sore. I said, you know, I knew it was that. I said, that's that dog. I should have washed my hands. Everybody said, Pastor, you should have washed your hands. Now, don't say, mind my pastor, you don't wash your hands. I bet you some of y'all ain't wash your hands. But check this out. The next time I came to his house, the architect's house, I saw the dog. This is what I did. I didn't mean to do what I did, but I did it out of reflex because I know my abundant life rights. He was coming at me growling this time. You know what I did? I said, I bind you in the name of Jesus. And that dog went and ran in the other room. Then I came back 3 weeks later to get the plans from the architect, and it got real quiet in the living room as I was waiting for him to bring me the plans. I said, where's the dog at? This is what he said. He dead. Then I had a friend come to my house, and we had a dog, and my dog barked at him, and he got ready to bind the dog. My wife said, you better not bind my dog. The point I want to make is that when you give your heart to Jesus Christ, when you become a child of God, when you let go of sin, when you let go of the enemy, when you let go of what Satan has to offer, which will only offer you something that will destroy you, Satan will take you farther than you want to go and keep you longer than you want to stay. Satan thrills, but he kills. He'll rob you of your life. He'll use sin to draw you in, but then he'll get you bound by that sin to destroy your life. You have a drink. Say, Pastor, I'm just having a drink. Before long, that drink will have you. If you don't let go of sin and thank God for Jesus, when he comes into your heart, he breaks the power of sin off your life. He'll break the power of that desire that's in your life. When I first gave my heart, when I began to give my heart to God, when I was in college, I said, God, I want to sell out to you, but I like marijuana. I said, God, if you want me to serve you, you're going to have to take this marijuana addiction out of my life. And I ain't lying. Within 2 days, the marijuana was gone. Me and my friend, we were pouring marijuana down the toilet stool on the college campus because I was free. I found out something. I found a Savior that gave me more joy and more happiness and more peace and more high than that drug could give me. And God will give you more peace, more happiness, more fulfillment than that sin that's trying to bind you up. Satan will bind you up so bad, it'll be below zero outside at 12 o'clock at night. He'll say, get up and go get that drug. Get up and go get that guy. Get up and go get that woman. Get up and go do that secret sin that you don't want nobody to know about. He wants control. He's busy. But right now, I take authority over the devil right now in Jesus' name. I bind him off of you. I bind Satan's attack against you. I bind every trick, every lie that the devil wants to try to bring to pass in your life. Every yoke, every hindrance, I bind it in Jesus' name. Now, it's one thing for me to bind it, but it's another thing for you. When you accept Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, you can experience abundant life and you can bind the enemy off of you as well. Off your family, off your finances, off your children, off your investments, off your money, in Jesus' name. Finally, not only will God forgive you of your sins and break the sin bondage off your life, not only will God give you abundant life, hello somebody, a life filled with all good things from God. The resurrection of Jesus Christ matters because Jesus Christ has provided a way for everyone to experience eternal life in heaven. Everybody say eternal life. Eternal life. Eternal life is when this life ends here, it begins somewhere else. Oh, I'm going to say that again. Eternal life is when this life ends. It begins, when this life ends here, it begins somewhere else. The greatest news is that God has provided a way for everyone to experience eternal life with him. Because he sent his only son, Jesus, to die on the cross to pay the penalty for all our sins, to remove the obstacle that was in the way from you having a relationship with a holy God. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. Whoever believes in me, though they die, yet shall they live. However, the gift of eternal life only comes to those who believe and trust in Jesus Christ. Now, I would be remiss if I didn't tell you that if you reject God's free gift of salvation through faith in Jesus Christ, you will miss eternity in a place called heaven, but yet go to a place for eternity called a place called hell. Hell is a place of eternal pain, eternal suffering, eternal darkness, and it's eternal. No such thing as parole. No such thing as 5 to 10, 10 to 15, 15 to 20. Hell is a place of easy entrance, but no exit. And it's eternal. You might say, Pastor, you're trying to scare me. You're trying to scare me about hell. I'm not trying to scare you. I'm just trying to warn you. Because the Bible says it's appointed to all people once to die, and after that, the judgment. If you don't have Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, there's nothing that God can do for you on the other side. God is drawing each and every one of you all right now who have not given their life to Jesus. If you feel like I got to get close to Jesus, that's God moving on your heart right now. If you sense someone inside and say, I ain't got it all together. I ain't all a bag of chips and whatnot. And I got people thinking I'm doing well and whatnot. If God's showing you some area of your life that's weak or that has sin in it, God is trying to show you right now that you need him. That you need to come to him. The Bible says now is the day of salvation. Look at me. Don't get distracted. Jesus said now is the day of salvation. Now is the acceptable time. Tomorrow's not guaranteed. You may not live till tomorrow. You say, Pastor, I'm young. I'm 14. I'm 15. I'm 17. You don't judge how old you are by your birthday. You judge how old you are by your death day. If you are 17 years old and you're going to die tomorrow, you're an old 17-year-old person right now because you ain't got long to live. The Bible says now is the day. Everybody say now. Now is the day of salvation. Now is the acceptable time. You say, Pastor, I don't believe in hell. Let me ask you this. Can I ask you this question? Do you believe in a place called Cook County Jail? Where people go who do wrong? You say, Pastor, I hear what you're saying, but I still don't believe. I'm a gambling person. Well, you better roll a 7 on the first try. Jesus wants you to be saved right now. Don't put it off till tomorrow. God brought you here. He said, my uncle brought here. My friend invited me. My cousin, my coworker invited me. Yeah, God may have used them to get you here, but it was God's spirit that drew you here. The Bible says a person can't even come to God unless his spirit draws. And God is drawing you right now. If you have not accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior, God is drawing you to the foot of the cross that you might be forgiven, that you might experience abundant life, that you might experience eternal life. Let me close with this story. And I'm going to ask you a question. What choice would you make? If you was in a desert, somebody dropped you off, person you thought was your friend, dropped you off in the middle of the desert, and you was walking, trying to find somebody that could help you out. Trying to find somewhere you can get some deliverance, some help. So maybe somebody got some water or something like that. And you're just trying to get some help. And when you're all by yourself, and a lot of people today are all by themselves. There's some people here today that's all by yourself. You feel almost suicidal. You feel like nobody understands. Nobody cares. Nobody loves you. Nobody is interested in you. But I'm here to tell you that God loves you, that God cares about you, and God is concerned about you, and God wants you to come to him. If you were that person in the desert and you're just coming up and all of a sudden you see like you see a mirage, but the mirage is real. You see two people and you come up and you stumbled up to the two people and get this. One of them's dead and one of them's alive. And you need a drink, you need some deliverance, you need some help. Let me ask you, who would you ask for advice? Jesus is alive. He's not a dead Savior. He's alive. I want to give you an opportunity. I want to pray for everyone here that wants to receive Jesus Christ. God loves you. He wants you. He's pulling on you right now. I can feel it in my spirit. There's an anointing of God pulling on you right now to come to him. Let's everyone stand. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Glory. Saints are praying that know how to pray. This is the most important part of this service. I want to pray for all those who want to, Pastor myself, to pray for you, to come into agreement with you, to receive Jesus Christ. I also want to pray for those who say, Pastor, I was walking with God. I did receive Jesus Christ, but I'm not walking with God. I haven't experienced the abundant life. And I want the abundant life of Jesus Christ right now. I want to give you an opportunity to come to the altar. The altar is a place of letting go of the past and letting go of guilt and letting go of shame. If you want to let go of guilt and let go of shame, I want everyone here that wants me to pray for them to either receive Jesus Christ or to rededicate your life to Christ. I want you to come here. I want you to stand here in a group and I want to pray over you and come into agreement with you. How many people here can say, Pastor, I know I'm saved. I'm 100% sure. I know where I'm going when I die. I'm 100% sure. Raise your hand. Okay, thank you. Put your hands down. I want to pray for everyone who could not raise their hand. If you're here today, say, Pastor, pray for me. I believe God is talking to me. Pastor, I believe everything that you said in that message. I believe you're sincere. I believe that God wants me to come to him. You might be there and you say, Pastor, you just don't know. I've done this and I've done that and I've made some mistakes and whatnot. God says, he's not talking about your mistake. He just says, come. He just says, come. Turn to the person on your right and on your left and say, Jesus just said, come. See, Pastor, you just don't know. I made some mistakes. No, he ain't talking about the mistakes you made. He's just saying, come. He's just saying, come. And I want you to come right here and stand. Yes, come on, come on. Everybody, come on. I want you to come. Everybody say, Pastor, pray for me. I want to give my heart to Jesus. I want the abundant life that he had to offer. I want forgiveness of sin. I want forgiveness of guilt. I want to get guilt taken out of my heart. I want to get guilt taken out of my mind. If that's you, come, come, come. Jesus said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden. I'll give you rest. The first thing God's going to give you is rest. He's going to give you rest from sin. He's going to give you rest from guilt. Yes, they keep coming. Keep them encouraged, saints. Keep them encouraged, saints. Saints are praying. Saints are praying. They know how to pray. Come on down here right now. Right now, Jesus says, come. Don't miss out. Don't miss out on this prayer. Don't miss out on this special Easter Resurrection Sunday. Come. Come if the friend next to you don't come. You come. You say, Pastor, sometimes it's hard to be first. Yeah, I know it's hard to be first, but only you know your condition. Only you know you. You say, Pastor, I wanna sell out to God. Now I know it's more people here that need to be down here, because the Lord showed me 50 to 60 people gonna get saved every Sunday at this church. It's harvest time. It's not time to play out in the world. It's time to come to Jesus. I want you to turn to your neighbor on your right and on your left and say, come on, let's go down there. I'll go with you. Turn to him. Just say, I'll go with you. I'll stand with you. Come on, let's go. Let's go get right with God. Now is the time to get right with God. Now is the time to get your sins forgiven. Don't get distracted. Don't get distracted. The devil will try to get you distracted. The devil, he will try to get you distracted, but you need to come and receive from God, Almighty God, what only Almighty God can give you. I want to encourage you, come on down. Come on down to the altar. Let's pray. Let's pray. Let's pray. Come on. Come on. God love you. Come on down. I'll walk down there with you. Come on. Come on. That's it. Come on. Come on. Come on. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. God bless. There are others. There are others. There are others. There are others. I sense in my spirit, Satan is trying to lie to you. If you listen too long to the devil, he'll talk you right out of the will of God. Your best life is down at the altar. Come on, Christopher. You're a man of God. Come on. Come on, draw. Your friend, you want to come? Come on. She'll follow you. Come on down. Yes, it. Come on down, man. Your mama been praying for you. Your mama been praying for you. A lot of your mama's been praying for you all. You need to come down right now. Young man, you need to come on down. Don't stay right there. God got something good for you. God's got an eternal life. He's got forgiveness of sin. Get on down there. Get on down there. Get on down there. Young man, come on. The Spirit of God is on you right now. He's saying, come. The Spirit of God is drawing you, young man. Come on down. This is the best decision you will ever make. God will give you your best life. If you want your best life, you need to come on down. Come on down right now. That's it. Come on. You too. Come on. Come on. That's it. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. You, God has something beautiful. He wants to give you more. If you'll just come down to the altar, God will give you more. He told me that. He said he wants to give you more. That's it. Keep her encouraged. That's it. God bless. What's your name? Patrice. God wants to give you more. God wants to give you more. God wants to give you more. Oh, yes. Come. Come. You want more from God? Come. Come on, come on, come on, come on. You too, come on. Huh? You want more from God? Come on. You got to step out in faith. You got to step out in faith. Faith is being assured of what God said he would do. Sir, do you need healing in your body? You need healing in your body. God told me you need healing in the area of your body. Do you need healing in your body? Jesus is the healer. Thank God for doctors, but the healer is Jesus. I thank God for doctors. They practice medicine, and they will practice on you. But Jesus is the healer. Sir, God told me to tell you, come on down and heal your body. Sir, it's time to sell out to Jesus. You want to sell out to Jesus? You want more? Come on. Come on, sir. Come on. Come on. Come on. Don't miss the opportunity. Don't miss. I command you to come to Jesus right now. I command you to sell out to Jesus right now. Sir, I've been watching you doing a service. God has something wonderful for you. He wants you to come, but you got to come. You got to step out in faith. Do you want more from God? You got more? Okay. All right. Pray. You satisfied already? Okay, you good. What about you, ma'am? Okay. Well, thank God for you coming. Praise God. Will, it's time to sell out to God. Come on down to the altar. What God has for you, what you're holding on to, will pale in comparison to what God has for you. Young man, you ready to sell out? You sold out already. See you at Sunday school. Praise the Lord. Who all said they got enough of Jesus? You said you got enough? I'd like to invite you to Sunday school. Praise the Lord. God bless you. All right. Look at me, you all. Look at me. I'm so glad you came. I'm so glad you came. I'm so glad that you came. But the person that's more happy and more glad that you came is Almighty God. He loves you more than I could ever love you. And his love will covers a multitude of sins. The beautiful thing about coming to Jesus and giving your heart to Jesus and selling out to Jesus is that he washes you white as snow, as if you never did anything wrong. His blood is that powerful to knock out everything that you did wrong, to take guilt out of your mind and wash you white as snow, so that you can be able to stand before a holy God and say, like I say in the morning, hello, God, how you doing? And he looks down at me and says, how you doing, son? And there's no guilt or shame in between me and God because of the blood of Jesus Christ that washed me white as snow. Now, not only did he wash me, but he will wash you. How many people want to be washed by the blood of the Lamb? To have all your sins removed as far as the east is from the west, as far as he will remove your transgressions from you. Saints are praying that know how to pray. Saints are praying that know how to pray. This is the most important time. Repeat after me, everyone. Dear God, you know my life. You know what I've done. I ask you, Jesus, to wash me with your blood. Pour out your mercy upon me. Clean my life of all sin. Deliver me from all sin. In Jesus' name. Jesus, I love you because you first loved me. And Jesus, I thank you for loving me, even though I'm not perfect. Now, who's up here to receive Jesus Christ for the first time? Just slip your hand up. I see your hand. Who wants to receive Jesus Christ for the very first time? Just raise your hand. I want to pray with you first. You? Okay. Have you received Jesus Christ into your heart? You asked him to come in and save you, give you eternal life? You have. You've done that before. Okay, I'm gonna pray a prayer of rededicating one's life. But I'm going to pray with my man over here. Him. It's Christina's son. Praise the Lord. How'd you get here?
My mom.
Your mama brought you here. Isn't that beautiful? Praise the Lord. How many people brought somebody here? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. That's how people come to Jesus, because somebody brought them. Okay, I'm going to pray with you. Who else? Okay. Could you stand with this gentleman right here? And you want to receive Jesus Christ for the first time? Isn't that wonderful? Get out of here. Do you know this guy right here? I know him. His name is Chris. The thing that will make life the best is you receiving Jesus Christ. I'm not talking about a religion or an idea. I'm talking about a person who will come into your life and live on the inside of you. Repeat after me. Dear God, I thank you for sending your son Jesus to die on the cross for me. Jesus, forgive me of my sins. Wash me with your blood. I believe, Jesus, that you died on Calvary's cross. You was buried, but on the third day, you got up out of that grave. And when I die, because I've accepted Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, I'm going to get up out of the grave too and spend eternity with God in heaven. Thank you, Jesus. Come into my life. Live on the inside of me. Save me right now in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. You believe that prayer? You believe that prayer? You believe that prayer? Because you believe that prayer, that Jesus died on the cross, was buried, and rose again from the grave on the third day, you are now saved. And I want to be the first to welcome you into the family of God. Ladies first. Welcome to the family of God. Welcome into the family of God. Welcome into the family of God. Hallelujah. Praise God. Somebody give God some praise. On Resurrection Sunday, three people got saved. Three people came into the kingdom of God. Oh, hallelujah. That's the greatest news of heaven. The Bible says heaven is rejoicing over you three. Heaven is rejoicing over you three today. They shouting in heaven. Angels are shouting. God's shouting. He's excited because you have received his gift. His son Jesus, who died on the cross, was buried and rose again on the third day. When you stand before God, God said, give me one good reason why I should let you spend eternity with me in heaven. You'll be able to say on March 31st, I responded to the altar call. And I asked you, Jesus, to come into my life and save me. And you know what God will do? Come on in. Come on in. You have accepted my son. God said, you love my son? That means you love me. Come on in. Isn't that wonderful? Praise God. Okay, I want to pray. You accepted Jesus Christ too? Shake my hand. You were praying that prayer all along while we were praying. Why didn't you say so? Father, I thank you for my... Did you believe that prayer?
Yes.
Father, I thank you for my sister. Hallelujah. Who received Jesus Christ today. Father, we thank you as well. I thank you for her as well. And I know heaven's rejoicing over her as well. Father, I thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. And every believer said, amen. Praise God. What's your name?
Miracle.
Miracle. Oh, Miracle. That's a wonderful name. That's beautiful. Next Sunday is going to be Miracle Sunday. We have communion. Next Sunday is Miracle Sunday. If you need a miracle, you need to come back next Sunday and get your miracle. I want to pray for everybody else that's up here to say, Pastor, I just want more of God. God, I just want to rededicate my life. God, I haven't heard your voice in a while. God, I want to live for you. I want to live for you. I want to go all the way with you, God. I don't want to half step. The worst Christian is a Christian who is half stepping. What I mean by half stepping, they got one foot in the world, one foot in God. And see, God don't want you to be confused. He wants you to be all the way in God, because he was all the way for you when he died on Calvary's cross. When they put a crown of thorns on his head and nails in his hand and nails in his feet, he was all the way, all the way. all the way for you. Repeat after me. Repeat after me. Dear God, I sell out to you today. I want to go all the way with you. Forgive me of my sins. Wash me with your blood. And Lord, cause your Holy Spirit, pour out your Holy Spirit upon me that I might live in a way that's pleasing to you, a holy way. Lord, fill me with your Spirit, your Holy Spirit, right now, that I might please you all my days. In Jesus' name. Let me pray over you. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I come against every lie of the devil. I come against hex, faxes, spells, jinx, work of witchcraft, ungodly soul ties. I bind them right now in the name of Jesus. Ungodly friendships, I bind them off of them right now in the name of Jesus. Ungodly habits, I bind them off of them in the name of Jesus. Satan, you take your hand. I come against oppression. I come against depression. I come against suicide spirits right now in the name of Jesus. I come against low self-esteem. I bind that spirit in the name of Jesus off of you right now in Jesus' name. Say in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Let's give them a hand. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Now, we have altar workers that want to give you something that'll help you in your spiritual growth and development. So they're going to give you something. Please fill that card out and give them to the ushers at the door before you leave out. Amen. You may be seated. Praise the Lord. Let's give God one more praise for these people, who, young people and older people who have come forward and saying that they want more of God. They want God. They want to be saved. I am so happy to have here today my friend, Alderman Derek Curtis. We met before he was an alderman. We met right there at the fence when our church was having vacation Bible schools, and we had a whole bunch of kids come, and they were in the parking lot, and we was telling them about Jesus, and Derek Curtis, Alderman Derek Curtis, before he was an alderman, we met and we talked right between the fence and went there. He said, "What you got going on here?" I said, We got children coming to Jesus. We telling people about Jesus, how they can get saved at a young age and sell out to God. That's how I got saved. I got saved 5 years old. And Jesus said, "Suffer little children, forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of God." And I got saved as a little kid. And that's how we met. And I would like Alderman Derek Curtis, let's give him a hand as he come. Praise the Lord. The Bible says, "Give honor to whom honor due." Alderman Derek Curtis, would you come up and have a few words? Good to have you. I got your text last night.
Thank you, Pastor. First, giving all honor and praises to God, I am very, very glad to be here this morning. We thank God for Jesus and his son and the sacrifices that his son made to give us all the right to the tree of life. I want to thank you for that. I want to thank my neighbors, the Dryers, that invited my family here this morning. Oh, there they are, right up in the corner. Thank you. I don't feel like a stranger. I'm right here at home. I didn't know Pastor remember that story how we met. It's been a blessing. It's been a blessing. As I continue, I've visited, oh my God, since I've been alderman, probably 85% of the churches in the community, because that's very important. And I'm glad that you prayed this morning, because I also want to pray just from Saturday, yesterday, to this morning. 27 people were shot in the city of Chicago. 3 died. 27 people, and we have to continue and thank you for bringing those souls right to God today. Again, that's very important. The most important thing, Pastor, as God is real, the devil is real also. So you have to know who you let in your life, in your house. I'm going to say, because when I get home after we go to our own church today, I'm going to ask my wife, "What happened to my dog?" I've been bugging her about that. What happened to my dog? I appreciate everyone here today. I appreciate you, the Dryads, inviting us. It's been a wonderful. You've just been such a blessing. And you know, look at this room now. I remember a few years ago we came and you had the vision to get a larger facility. And that one didn't work out, of course, because they had other plans for that. God had other plans for that. But I do want to share with you a really, really good plan, though, that you might like in the community, right down the street. So we'll be talking, Pastor.
All right. Okay.
I appreciate it.
All right. Let us pray for you, yes, okay? Because if you all wouldn't mind standing up and stretching your hands toward the alderman and his wife, his lovely wife. God bless you. Thank you for coming. They need our prayers. The Bible says pray for all those that are in authority that we might live a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and righteousness. For God would have all men to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. If we don't pray for our leaders, it's going to make it harder for people to get saved. If they allow laws to be passed that are anti-God, it's going to be difficult for people to receive Jesus Christ. So we want to pray for our aldermen. We also want to pray for your health. Amen. God is in the healing business. We want to pray for your marriage and your family. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you, Father God, that you're in the soul-saving business.
Yes.
And you love humanity. You love everybody. Lord, we pray, Father God, for Alderman Derek Curtis. We ask, Lord, you put a strong anointing on him to be able to stand down the attacks of the devil. Put a conviction in his heart, Father God, to stand for righteousness in your holy word. Lord, you said it was wisdom and the word of God that is the stability of a nation. Jeremiah 33:6. Lord, give him wisdom, give him knowledge, Father God, from your word, Lord, as he governs and watches over the 18th district. We pray, Father God, for his body. We ask, Lord, you heal him. We speak to every organ in his body. We come against every attack of the enemy. We come against every system in his body that's not functioning according to divine health, his respiratory system, circulatory system, digestive system. Every system in his body, every organ in his body, I decree that his blood is whole in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
Lord, you said the life of the flesh is in the blood. I pray for his kidneys, Father God, his liver. Lord, purify his kidney, his liver, his heart, Father God. Every nerve, aorta in his chest, Father God, in his neck, in his brain. We come against premature death. You redeemed us from leaving here before our time. Let him live long. Let him live as long as he wants. Never want as long as he lives. Father, we also pray for his marriage, his wife, Father God. Oh, God. Lord, it takes a strong woman to support a strong man. We ask, Lord, that you anoint her, that you strengthen her, that you give her what she needs. Give her, Lord, what you would have her to give to her husband. Lord, help her to be patient and sensitive. Lord, we pray, Lord, protection over her. We come against the devil that has tried to destroy her in the name of Jesus. We come against every attack. We bind the devil. I bind the devil off of you in the name of Jesus. I plead the blood of Jesus over you from the crown of your head and your husband's head to the sole of your feet. And Lord, bless their marriage. Their family, Father God. Bless their marriage, Father God. Lord, give Alderman Derek Curtis a special appreciation of his wife. Let him always value her, treating her as the vessel that you've given her to him, given to him. Strengthen her, Father God. Lord, help them to value one another like never before. Strengthen my brother, Lord, Alderman Derek Curtis, as he watches over his wife, shepherds his wife, his family. Pray for his children, grandchildren, relatives, Father God. Watch over his whole family, God. We plead your blood over them. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah. God bless you. Amen. Praise the Lord. Amen. Well, you may be seated. Amen. God bless you, sister. We love you. All right. Praise the Lord. Amen. Final announcements. I know we got pictures you can take over here at this mirror behind, with this mural in the background. You're free to do that. Do we have food downstairs? We do? Okay, we get Whole Foods 3 times a week, and we give it out every Sunday. So you might, I saw some salmon down there and chickens and carrying on. It ain't down there all the time, but there are times when it is, but you can find something down there. I like to say, if you don't have a good church, we want you to join this church. You need somebody praying for you. You don't need to be out there in this world, in this time, without a shepherd. One time people came to Jesus and said, well, how come these people are having all their problems? He said, they're sheep without a shepherd. You need a pastor as a shepherd. You need to be in a church. So all you got to do is be born again. You can join today. You can shake my hand. I'll be at the back door. You can shake my hand and join today. Then right after that, we have a new members class that you come to. Okay? I think that's pretty much the announcements. Oh, yeah, if you forgot to give your tithes and offerings and you came late, you can see the lady at the back, the secretary's at the back, and leave your tithes and offerings. We appreciate your partnership. We thank you for it. Also, next Sunday is Communion Sunday. It's also Miracle Sunday. If you need a miracle, then you need to be here next Sunday, 10 o'clock. And I think that's it. And I think the next big event is Mother's Day. Mother's Day. Pastor's Appreciation. Okay. Love to have you come. Amen. Let me pray. Father, we just thank you right now in the name of Jesus, Lord. We thank you for the word that went forth. We thank you for your son, Jesus, most of all, who died on a cross for our sins, was buried, but rose again on the third day that we might have eternal life, forgiveness of sins. Father, we thank you. Bless your people this day in Jesus' name. And everyone said, amen. Church, I commend you into the grace and the peace of God. God bless you.